Good morning, and welcome to worship on what is a snowy morning here in New Jersey. We did this service instead of being live streamed, obviously, is pre-recorded instead because we wanted to be able to keep those of us who do come into the sanctuary safe in the snow. So I hope that you are cozy and warm at home as we worship God together this morning. My name is Allison Phillip. I'm the pastor of First United Methodist Church in Westfield. And together we seek to love God and to love our neighbor in all that we do, and to sow seeds of love, grace, and joy in the world around us. If you're joining us today, I invite you to take some time to submit prayer requests using the form that is in the video description. You can click and submit any concerns that you have on your mind and your heart today, and know that we'll be praying with you and for you. Also, I invite you, if you are moved to give at any point in the service, there's a link that you can click to give online as well. And finally, a little bit later in the service, we'll be having communion together, sharing communion together. So I invite you to get some bread and some juice or water ready for that special meal that reminds us of our connection to each other as the body of Christ. And the body of Christ can connect us from wherever we are into one and empower us for our ministry in the world. Leading up to Lent, FUMC Westfield is looking at the Psalms, which are kind of the prayer book of the Bible, and listening in them for things that can inform our prayer life today. Today we're listening to Psalm 27, we're hearing Psalm 27 and taking a look at it together. And as our opening prayer, we'll be using words of Psalm 27 in connection with words that Jesus gave us in the Great Commandment in the Gospels. And so I invite you to follow along. Your parts will be on the screen. And just a note, these words come from a Celtic Christian community in Northumbria, England. And their prayer is that group of people pray together every morning as part of their morning prayer. They hear these words from the Psalm and from the Gospel. One thing I have asked of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. Who is it that you seek? Do you seek him with all your heart? Do you seek him with all your soul? Do you seek him with all your mind? Do you seek him with all your strength?
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, triumphs of thy grace. My gracious master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and
everyone. Happy Sunday. I hope you had a great time this week playing in the snow. There sure was a lot of snow to play in. I wanted to share something with you today that's special to me, and that is something that we found in the book of Psalms. Psalms, we've been talking about in church for the past few weeks, is a book smack in the middle of the Bible, of a book of songs and a book of poems. We hear a lot of the books that talk about the stories of Jesus or the history of God's people, but there is indeed in the middle of the Bible a book of songs. And the easiest way that I learned to find the book of Psalms is to hold up your Bible, open up to the middle, halfway through, and you will be in the book of Psalms. Someone once told me that was because God wanted songs in the center of our life. I wanted to share with you from the book of Psalms, there's several of them, and they were all written by different people, but King David was one of the people that wrote a lot of the Psalms. And one of the Psalms he wrote was Psalm 18, and it begins this way. I love you, O Lord, my strength. It's a very short verse, it's just verse one, and it says a lot, because God wants, love David, and David knew that God loved him. God brought him comfort, God brought him safety, God brought him many wonderful things throughout his life, and God and David were friends. And when you have a friendship with someone, you like to talk both, you like to have conversations, you like to talk back and forth, you like to share ideas, and you like to remind them, you're my friend and I love you. And that's how David begins this song, I love you, Lord, my strength. And it reminded me of a song that I learned in Sunday school, you probably learned it in Sunday school, called Jesus Loves Me. Jesus Loves Me is a reminder that Jesus loves us. And we find that in stories throughout the Bible and in stories people share with us. But I learned something else. I learned something in addition. I learned a second verse to that song that I'm not sure you might have learned. So I'd like to share it with you. Please forgive my singing. The verse goes this way. I love Jesus, does he know? Have I ever told him so? Jesus loves to hear me say that I love him every day. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Thank you for listening. And so let's take some time right now to tell God that we love him, to tell Jesus we love him. Will you pray with me? Because that's how we can talk to God. Dear God, thank you for all the wonderful things you've done for us. Thank you for bringing us comfort when we're afraid, or keeping us safe when things are a little scary. Thank you for the friends you surround us with. Thank you that you laugh with us when we see something funny. But thank you most of all for being you. God, we love you every day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
The Psalms are a prayer book and a playlist. They were composed as songs for worship that capture the full range of human experience. Today we hear from Psalm 27, a song about seeking God. Listen for God's Spirit speaking to your spirit. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom should I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. To behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me on a high rock. Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You who have been my help, do not cast me off. Do not forsake me. O God of my salvation, if my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So two falls ago, which feels like a universe ago sometimes, two falls ago, the young adult group at our previous church planned a trip to go apple picking. And so I thought it'd be nice if we brought the girls along too, because what kids don't love apple picking? And so we drove about an hour to get to the orchard. Some people were late. It was a very hot day for late September. And my kids apparently don't love apple picking or didn't love apple picking as much as I anticipated that they would. Rose in particular, she was two at the time, she didn't want to walk. She was sweaty from the heat, and she hadn't napped in the car as we had planned. And what's more, this orchard, it stretched over a slope that got steep at points. And so it was not a place for carrying around a two-year-old very easily. Fortunately, the orchard provided wagons, little red wagons, that you could use to cart around the bushel baskets that they gave you to put apples in. And the wagons were also good for carting around small children. But again, it was a warm September day. It was crowded, so there were no wagons available. I was going to put our name on the list in case one of them opened up, and as I went, I saw a couple of older kids who were using their wagon to pull each other and to flip each other out of the wagon. So very nicely, I went up and I asked them, hey, when you're done, can I have your wagon for my toddler? They looked at me a little bit embarrassed, gave me the wagon right away. So nice kids. First mission accomplished. Now we've got a wagon. So then we go from apple tree to apple tree with Rose in the wagon, along with a big basket, a big bushel basket that we can put apples in front of her. And not long, we went row by row through the trees, and not long, the basket was full of all kinds of different apples of different colors and sizes and flavors. And we were ready to turn around and to head back down the slope. When Sajin turned the wagon, at that same moment, Rose also leaned over just a little, and suddenly our whole basket of apples and Rose toppled out of the wagon. Sajin rushed to pick Rose up. She was startled, but fine. And then we picked up the apples that we could get, the ones that hadn't rolled down, and we went down the hill to check out. Needless to say, at this point, we were very ready to go home. So we got to the car, Sajin touched his front shirt pocket, and he realized that his glasses were missing, which he needs to drive. The adventure continues. So he stayed with the girls by the car while I trekked back up the hill, and I went up and down the rows of apple trees that I remembered us visiting. And then I remembered the wagon spilling at that particular spot, and so I did my best to find it. I found the spot where I thought it was, but I looked around, couldn't see any glasses. Some of the others in our group had found me at this point. They saw me, and they were walking over to try to help look in the grass to see if they could find anything. And as one of them approached, her shoe landed in such a way that it lifted up the grass and the leaves around it just a little bit. And I saw a flash of light. The glasses. They were under the grass, there were leaves over them too. I reached out and I grabbed them just before her other shoe would have stepped right on them. Now, I was pretty proud of myself for that. It was a huge stretch of orchard. And somehow I had found this little pair of glasses lost in the grass. Jesus says at one point in the Gospels, "Seek and ye shall find, ask and ye shall receive." So I had sought and I had found. Seek and ye shall find. Our psalm today encourages seeking too. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Today we're spending time with this psalm, which is about seeking not an object that we can find in a field, not something that we can touch and feel with our hands, but seeking God. It must be a very human longing, seeking for God. For thousands and thousands of years, people have been seeking. The psalm was written over 2,500 years ago, and its words have been prayed through the centuries. Sometimes this longing for God shows up in our seeking other things, substitutes for God in a sense. Did any of you read Elizabeth Gilbert's memoir called Eat, Pray, Love? I can't see your answers, but I'm guessing maybe some of you have. I'm pretty sure they made it into a movie at one point with Julia Roberts. And it tells the story about how in a time of brokenness in her life after her divorce, Elizabeth Gilbert travels around the world seeking something. She doesn't know what it is, but seeking something. And so she spends time eating fancy food in Italy. She spends time doing yoga in India. And she spends time looking for romance in Bali. Maybe you have your own version of this story. Times when your longing for God has left you on a search for God. And maybe along the way, there are times when you might mistake substitutes for the real thing. I know I have my version of that story. Human beings are seekers of God. We are seekers of the ultimate. Sometimes we turn to other things, but still we seek. That's what Psalm 27 today is about. But does the psalmist find the thing he's hoping for in this psalm? He's seeking. Where does that seeking take him? And what can we learn from that about our own seeking? I want to take a look at a few verses to see what we can learn about our own seeking from what this psalmist does and from where his seeking leads him. The psalm starts off with the line, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?" The words for light and fear here sound similar in Hebrew, and so there's this a similarity of sound, a wordplay, but an opposition of concepts. Fear and light are opposites here. In the midst of fear, the writer turns to the light of God. The writer seeks the light in the midst of whatever else is vying for his attention. Now, it's not clear that he actually does see God. And the psalm kind of explores that. It goes through more stanzas of him seeking God. And then we get to the end, where the writer offers what is essentially a statement of faith. He says, I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. A statement of faith. It's a statement that's an echo of earlier in the Bible, of the story of Moses, who in the book of Exodus leads the people through the desert. In Exodus 33, Moses wants to see God's face and is prohibited from it. But instead, God shows Moses God's goodness. The story tells us that the goodness of God passed in front of Moses, and Moses could see this goodness, even though he couldn't see God's actual face. That story sheds some light on the psalm. It seems that this is what's also going on in the psalm, and for people today too. We seek after God. Maybe we can't always see God just as we want to. But God gives us evidence of God's goodness around us. We see God's goodness in glimmers of light, like I saw as I sought out the glasses. It was a glimmer that let me catch the presence of the thing that I was looking for. I was seeking this lost pair of glasses, and I saw them when somebody stepped and I caught a flash of light. Psalm 27 is an invitation to seek those flashes of light, those glimmers of light. It's to believe that those glimmers are chances to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. I wonder sometimes if the psalmist has experienced that sometimes we are looking for God, but we aren't sure where to look first. Or sometimes we're frustrated that it takes so long to find the thing we want to find in the way we want it. Sometimes we look in the expected places, but we don't find what we're looking for. But also sometimes when we are not expecting it, we get a flash of light and know that God is close. We are seekers of God. Like Jesus expressed, we can choose to seek to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's an important part of the religious instinct in us, to seek. But I also think, when I think about Christian faith in particular, that and what draws me to it, it's that our seeking is not the whole story. Faith is about seeking God, for sure. And Christian faith also teaches us that all the while we seek God, God is also seeking us. There's a series of parables in Luke's gospel that highlight this. In one of them, there's a shepherd who has 100 sheep, and one of those sheep gets lost. And so the shepherd leaves the 99 sheep trying to find that one missing sheep. And then the very next parable after that is about a woman who has 100 coins, but she loses one. She doesn't forget about the lost coin, but she sweeps her entire house clean looking for it. The implication is that God seeks each one of us just as fervently. There's times when teachers from beyond our tradition can give us words that help us see our own tradition, our own faith, in a fresh way. And this week I came across some words from a Sufi poet named Rumi that did this for me this week. He wrote once the line, "What you seek is seeking you." So not only is it that we seek and find, but it's that the God we seek is seeking us. That's the story of Jesus. Jesus seeks out each and every coin, each and every sheep. In Jesus, God takes on flesh to seek us in the mess of a dirty stable, or a dry desert, or a windy sea, or a crowded temple. In Jesus, God seeks to love us with all of God's mind, heart, soul, and strength. That is the ultimate source of our hope and our faith. For me, God's seeking me gives me courage to keep seeking the glimmers of light that come around me. I looked hard for those glasses in the orchard. And what led me to find them was partly because I was looking, partly my seeking. But I want to say that mostly it was grace. The grace of a footstep at just the right time. The grace of a ray of sunlight coming down at just the right angle. This experience, apple picking, became an image for me. It's become an image for me that not only do we seek God, but God is seeking us too, reflecting light at us in a million tiny moments, asking us to see and to soak up that goodness when it comes. So in the week ahead, our invitation is to behold the beauty of the Lord every chance that we get. It's to believe that we will see God's goodness in the land of the living. Yes, even now. It's to believe that the one who we are seeking is seeking us too. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh, Hi, I'm Tracy Bassman, Chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee, and I have another announcement this Sunday. Jonathan Evers, FUMC Westfield's Music Director, has decided to step down from his position effective February 14th. We will celebrate Jonathan's talent and time at FUMC Westfield on Sunday, February 14th during the live stream service and Zoom fellowship hour afterwards. As part of this celebration, please share any contributions for Jonathan by mailing them to the church office, Attention Jonathan Collection, or making a gift online via Venko in the other field and just add a note that says Jonathan. We thank Jonathan for sharing his great musical talent with FUMC Westfield for the last almost 10 years and wish him the best as he takes his next steps. Please also pray for Staff Parish Relations Committee as we begin the process for finding a new music director. Thank you.
Christ our Lord invites to this table all who desire to know and love God better and who desire to live at peace with our fellow human beings. And so we start off this time of communion by having a time of silent confession when we lift up to God, when we're invited to lift up to God anything that separates us from God, from loving God, and from loving our neighbor. So let us have a time of silent confession. Hear the good news that God knows you, loves you, forgives you, and every day invites you anew to walk on the path that leads to abundant life. Thanks be to God. Amen. You know, earlier I said something along the lines of that we seek a God who we can't touch or feel. And on the one hand, that's true. And on the other, we have the sacraments, which are visible means of God's grace, which are ways that we believe that God shows up in concrete, ordinary ways to offer us God's presence and God's grace. So I invite you to join for communion today. If you don't already have bread and juice with you, you can go pause the video and go get some. Know that communion is a way that we are connected to each other as the body of Christ, and not just to each other today, but also to generations of Christians before us and to people all over the world. Communion connects us as the body of Christ. It feeds us with reminders of God's grace, helps us remember who we are, whose we are, and what our mission in the world is. And so we begin by giving thanks to God for God's continuous presence throughout human history, acting to save and to love from the time of the Psalms and before, all the way through the prophets, and up to the time of Jesus, when Jesus came as the Word made flesh to reconcile and to make new, to heal, to bring hope, and to invite us to show us what it looks like to live an abundant life, loving God and loving our neighbor. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to God, he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this as often as you eat of it in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God. And then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so, God, we give you thanks for these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, and for all the ways that you're present to us in our lives. God, I pray your Holy Spirit might make this bread and this cup be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until the day comes when we feast together at your heavenly banquet, when we feast together and see and taste and know the goodness of God completely and fully. God, you taught us to pray that your kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. And so we pray together now those words that you taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Know as you eat this bread that we are connected as one body and that God feeds us. And as you take this cup, know that it is the cup of life, the cup of salvation poured out for you. I invite you now to join me for the prayer after communion. God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
To reach the masses, men of every birth, for an answer Jesus gave the key. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, lift the precious Savior up, till he speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, the world is hungry for the living bread, lift the Savior up for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the word that he said, I'll draw all unto me. Well, lift him up, till he speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Don't exalt the preacher, and don't exalt the pew. Preach the gospel, simple, full, and free. Prove him, and you will find his promises true. I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, till he speaks from eternity. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Well, lift him up, till he speaks from eternity. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. By living as a Christian all, let the world in you the Savior see. Then men will gladly follow him who once taught, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, lift him up, lift the precious Savior up, till he speaks from eternity. Savior up till he speaks from eternity.
seek, find. And know that the one you seek is seeking you, offering you glimmers of the light that you need for this moment. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.